seated. I pray that we might hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. So over the past several weeks, I've been giving everyone the heads up in our congregation that starting today, we would be entering into a six-week stewardship program to spend some intentional time taking a look at what this Christian faith of ours has to say about what we're called to do with our money, how we're called to use our time, and how we're called to share our talents in pursuit of building up the church and furthering the gospel. And I'm going to be honest with you, like I have been since this was announced. A big reason why we need to do this is because in our congregation we're looking at a pretty substantial shortfall when it comes to being able to fully fund the ministries that we believe that God is calling us to at St. Jude's. In fact, I shared with you a few weeks ago that as of our last council meeting, it's looking like we are living into the $40,000 deficit that we budgeted for ourselves at our annual meeting back in January. Now that might seem like a pretty daunting amount. It might even lead some of us in our church family to say, what's the point? There's no way that we're going to raise that kind of money. And it's true. Increasing our regular givings, not just this year, but next year, and the year after that, and the year after that, increasing our givings by $40,000 just to maintain the ministries that we're currently involved with, let alone dream about what else God might be calling us to at St. Jude's. Yes, that's a pretty significant amount of money. And it can paralyze us with fear if we let it. But last week when I was reflecting on gratitude at our Harvest Thanksgiving celebration, I talked about, in regards to all of these emotions that we feel in any given day, in all the ways that we can react to any given situation, we always have a choice as to how we react. We can choose to live with gratitude no matter what we are facing in our lives. It's a choice we get to make. And so for the people of St. Jude's, we can choose to live in fear and despair because of the reality that we're currently living in, or we can choose to be a people who make the choice to live with hopeful expectation. We can choose to be a resurrection people that we know that we are, and we can choose to live with hopeful expectation, trusting in the words of the doxology that we say together every single week, that God, working in us, can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. When I was first ordained, and I was sent to my first parish, I was given some instructions from the bishop before I went to my first parish. And here are the instructions that I got. I was told to go up to that place and to pour my heart and soul into ministry for 2 years, and if after those 2 years things were still the same, the church was going to close. And so for 2 years, that's exactly what I did. I poured my heart and soul into that place. And guess what? They ran a deficit of about $50,000 in each of those 2 years. Things were pretty bleak. There was a whole lot of fear and uncertainty in that community about what the future was going to hold for them. But just that when things were at their darkest, I received a phone call at home one night from a lawyer. And the lawyer was calling to let me know that the church had just received a gift from the estate of one of our longtime parishioners who had died. She had given $5 million to fund the ministry of that church. God, working in us, can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. When I went to Tilsonburg, They were in absolute dire need of renovating and expanding their church building in order to be fully accessible and in order to be able to offer the ministry that that place needed to offer to the community that they were living in. The price tag was $500,000. People looked at that. People in that little congregation, they looked at that amount and they said, that can't be done. They said, we're never going to raise that kind of money. What's the point? And they were right. They didn't. When all was said and done, that small little congregation in Tilsonburg raised $800,000. And now they have a beautiful, accessible facility that allows them to offer ministry that needs to be offered in that place at that time. Much like what St. Jude's went through back in the 90s when you were working towards the renovation and the expansion that you were doing in this place. God, working in us, can and will do more than we can ask or imagine. So my hope is that we don't ever limit ourselves just to what we think might be possible. My hope is that we be that resurrection people that we're called to be. That we live with hopeful expectation. And that we put our trust in God. That with God, all things are possible. Now I have to be honest with you as I stand up here this morning. This isn't my favorite stuff to be talking about. Financial stewardship definitely is outside of my comfort zone. I don't have any particular experience or skills in leading a program such as the one that we're embarking on. And I've also been around the church long enough now to know that whenever the church talks about money, people tend to tune out. Or they roll their eyes. Or they start to grumble, here we go again. But here's the thing. It is because I love this church. It is because I see the potential for this church. It is because I believe with all my heart and all of my very being that God wants St. Jude's on the corner of Fanshawe Park Road and Adelaide Street, God wants St. Jude's to continue being a vibrant and faithful community in Christian service and worship. And because I believe that growing in generosity, that's not something that's just going to benefit the church. But because I believe it will ultimately lead each one of us in our own lives to experience more joy and purpose. For all those reasons, I stand up here this morning way outside of my comfort zone. I'm going to spend some time talking about how I believe our God is inviting you and inviting me to be extravagantly generous in supporting the ministry of the church. And we can support the ministry of the church through gifts of time, through gifts of money, through gifts of talent. And because I know that each one of you loves this church, because I know each one of you sees its potential and really and truly wants to see us be that vibrant community in faithful service, I ask only one thing over the next 6 weeks. That each one of us remains open to what the Holy Spirit might have to say to us about how we are called to invest in the ministry of this church. So let me tell you a little bit about what to expect over the next few weeks. You will hear a couple of sermons that focus on stewardship from a biblical perspective. You will hear a couple of sermons that hopefully provide some tools to help answer the question that's been asked for generation after generation, that timeless question, how much should I give? You will also be hearing from some members of our church family talking about what this church community has meant to them in their own lives and the importance that stewardship plays in their life. And then, every member of St. Jude's will receive a pledge sheet. Each and every one of us will receive a pledge sheet where we will be encouraged to prayerfully consider our contribution, what we are called to support and invest in the ministry of this church. Now I know that's not a typically Anglican thing to be doing. It's not a typically Anglican thing for us to fill out pledge cards. But I cannot stress enough the importance of having every member of our church family commit to doing this. Because first of all, it helps each one of us. It helps each one of us to be more intentional about our own financial support of the church. But this is also the only way that we are going to be able to know whether we have moved in the direction of being able to fully fund the ministries that we're called to at St. Jude's. That's the only way we're going to know if we're moving in that direction of being able to fully fund the ministries that we believe God has called us to, or if changes need to be made. Because the bottom line is that if this conversation we're going to be having is successful, that means we're going to be able to continue offering the ministries that we are currently investing in. Heck, we might even be able to start dreaming about what else God might be calling us to do. But if this conversation, if it's not as successful as we are praying and hoping it will be, then the reality is that we may have to start making cuts to some of the programs, some of the positions, and some of the ministries that we have always placed such a high value on here at St. Jude's. The only way for us to measure where we are in terms of planning for the future is if every member commits to returning this pledge card. Now, one thing I want to be absolutely clear on as we enter into this time. I think I've said this already once, but I want to be absolutely clear on this. This whole conversation that we're going to be having, it's not about paying the bills or covering the expenses of the church just for the sake of paying the bills or covering the expenses of the church. What this conversation is really and truly about, this is a conversation about us, the people of St. Jude's, being called to invest in the ministries that we truly believe our God is calling us to be participating in. It's about investing in the activities that excite us as the people of God. It's about investing in those ministries that we are passionate about in this place. Think for a minute about a time in your life when you felt called to be extravagantly generous in giving either of your time, your talents, or your money. Think for a minute about a time when you were called to do that. What made you do that? What motivated you to give of yourself in such a generous way? And why that particular thing? In the midst of all of the various things we can give our money to, we can give our time to, and we can give our attention to, why that one particular thing? Here's what I think. I think that we as human beings, I think we feel called to be generous in giving to those things that we are personally passionate about in our own lives. I think that we feel called to give to those things that we truly believe will make a difference in the lives of others. That we feel called to give to those things that we truly believe will bring hope and light to this world. When we encounter something like that, I think our hearts are stirred within us to be as extravagantly generous as we possibly can be. Now, I hope that everyone in the congregation has had a chance to take a look at this booklet. This booklet is called Telling Our Sacred Story. It's been emailed out to our parish family. It has been handed out last week at church. If you don't have a copy yet, there's still a few copies left at the back of the church. I would encourage you to pick one up and take it home, because in this whole conversation that we're having, I believe that this, the information that you will read in these pages, is vitally important to understanding what we're talking about. Because what this does is it takes our operating budget that we approve every year at our vestry. It takes that budget that lists everything in terms of expenses like insurance and hydro, salaries, and building costs. It takes that same information and it presents it in a way that shows us all of the ministry, all of the activities, all of the things, the life-giving things that happen in this place, because those bills get paid. Because when we just look at a budget, quite frankly, it's hard to get excited and passionate about being generous in giving to pay the hydro bill. I don't go home at the end of the day and say, Amy, let's crack out the checkbook. We gotta pay the hydro bill. That's not exciting and life-giving stuff to be giving to. But it's much easier to get excited. It's much easier to get passionate about being extravagantly generous in giving to those things we see as being life-giving, in giving to those ministries and activities that we are passionate about in this place. So as you read through this, as you see all of the things that happen at St. Jude's because we pay the hydro bill and because we pay the insurance and because you pay the salaries, don't think of it that way. Are there any particular ministries? Are there any activities that are happening in this place that excite you, that get you passionate, that you feel particularly called? If the answer to that question is no, we have a far bigger problem in this place than just a deficit. Because if there are ministries and activities and things that happen in this place that excite you, that make you passionate, that you feel called to, then what I would suggest is that each one of us use those things as both an invitation and an opportunity to prayerfully reflect on what it might look like in your own life to be as generous as you possibly can be in supporting that ministry that excites you. Let me share a few of the ministries and the things that happen here that excite me, that I'm passionate about, that make me want to be generous in giving to this church. I'm passionate about our worship in this place. And particularly when I think of our worship in this place, I think of the countless people who over the years have gathered in this holy space in order to mark the major moments of their lives. Whether it be celebrating the birth of a child, coming for a baptism or first communion or confirmation or a wedding, even funerals. There are so many people who, when they think back on these life-giving moments from their own life, they remember coming to this place. They remember gathering here for worship. They remember coming here to give thanks to God. They remember being part of a faith community that they've chosen to share these moments and to celebrate these moments with. To continue offering this as a place where people can come to do that, that's something that I'm passionate about. And it motivates me to want to be generous in supporting the ministry of the church. When I think about how we open our doors to all kinds of different community groups who use this building that we're blessed with, there is one that I'm particularly passionate about. Alcoholism runs in my family. I've seen the devastating effects that it can have on families and that it can have on the person who suffers from such an addiction. For some who are not touched personally by alcoholism, it might not seem like a big deal that we let a group like Alcoholics Anonymous use our building. But to see us open our doors, to see us offer a safe place of support and healing to those who suffer from this disease, that's a ministry I'm passionate about. That leads me to want to be more generous in giving to support the ministry of this church. It's the same with the ministry that we offer to our youngest members in this place. Obviously, I have two young kids. And so the ministry of Sunday school and youth group, it's obviously going to be close to my heart. It's important to me that our church family invests in these ministries aimed at nurturing and developing the faith of our youngest members. And my passion for this ministry, my excitement for this ministry, it motivates me to want to be generous in supporting the ministry of the church. Then there's the incredible work that we do in terms of reaching out beyond these walls. Because we don't exist just for what happens inside these walls. The ministry of what we offer to the vulnerable members of our community and to those in need, it's at the heart of who we are. As Christians, our priority, we're called to feed the hungry. We're called to clothe the naked. We are called to welcome the stranger. We are called to be a people who are committed to striving for justice. We are called from our baptism to respect the dignity of every single human being. When I see the generosity of this church family in terms of donations to the Daily Bread Food Bank, to sending bales of clothing to Northern Canada, to serving at the various hospitality meals around the city, to supporting the work of the Private World Relief and Development Fund, to sponsoring refugee families, to opening the doors to our nearly new shop, that stuff gets me excited. That's a ministry I can get passionate about. And all the ways I see us striving to be the hands and the feet of Jesus, serving others in love, that leads me to want to be as generous as I possibly can in supporting the ministry of this church. When you look over this list of ministries, when you think of all of the activities that happen here at St. James, which ones excite you? Which ones are you passionate about? Which ones lead you to want to be extravagantly generous? Any thoughts? Not a typical thing to do to respond back during a sermon, I know. What excites you about being a part of this church family? What do we offer in this place that you see as life? Sense of community, that people can come to this place and know that they are loved, know that they are accepted, and know that they're in a place where they're surrounded by God's love. What else?
Prayer.
We have a pastoral prayer team, pastoral and prayer team, as part of this church. We pray for one another's needs. We care for each other when we're sick. We reach out in love to one another. That's something to be passionate and excited about. Music. We are blessed with an amazing choir. We are blessed with an amazing musician. That ministry is exciting. That can lead us to want to be as generous as we possibly can in supporting the ministry of the church. Any others?
Our kids.
I know we long for the days when we can have 150 young members in our Sunday school like what we had, but you know what? We had a blessing of the backpack event at the beginning of September, and we had 17 backpacks last. When we have all of our kids here together at one time, we can have upwards of 25 to 30 kids in our hands. That's working in next several weeks.
Pray about this.
Pray about what we offer in this place.
God wants us to be.
God wants us to offer the ministries that we're called to in this place.
And then, as you reflect on how you can offer your own gift of money, your own gift of time, that's what might be important too.
It takes time, people's time, to offer the ministries that we offer.
Our talents,
as you reflect on what it is you feel called to offer, hold the words of the doxology in your heart. That when you offer a gift, when I offer a gift, God working in and through each one of us in this place will do more than we can ask or imagine. Amen.